he is promoting intercaste marriages in his own ashram. So argue, you know, once you promote intercaste marriages, you're not even defending Varna in theory. Now, when you look at caste today, you know, it's really a classic half full, half empty scenario. If we agree, and I think it's that caste discrimination in India is several thousand years old. In the last 70 years, Dalits, largely through their own efforts, but also through the constitutional guarantees, have pushed back against discrimination more effectively than at any time in the past. You know, maybe it should be more. I would say part of the fault, this is a subject for a separate discussion, part of the fault is that of the Gandhians after Gandhi. The Ambedkarites after Ambedkar took forward Ambedkar's message of fraternity and equality. The Gandhians after Gandhi neglected caste. Either like Nehru, they felt only class matters, like the communists, or people like Vinoba Bhave talked about all kinds of nonsense except caste. Right. So, but I would still say that given how deep root, how intrinsic untouchability was to the Hindu social order and to our scriptural tradition, I think the fact that Gandhi and Ambedkar, you could say Ambedkar did more than Gandhi, but Gandhi and Ambedkar from below and from above delegitimize the system to at least under the law say we are all equal is, I think, a major achievement. The last point I'd make is there's only one real difference, philosophical difference between Gandhi and Ambedkar, and that has to do with religion. Gandhi felt you can save Hinduism by ridding it of caste distinctions. Ambedkar felt that Dalits had no hope within the Hindu social order, they had to go outside. Now, in 1935, he said, I was born a Hindu, but I will not die a Hindu. But he converted only 21 years later. Now, it's an interesting counterfactual. If Ambedkar had converted in the late 1930s to Buddhism, maybe, you know, that means we would have, millions of people would have become Buddhists, and that would have actually weakened caste much more radically than anything else. The second part of the village, you know, I agree, largely, but not wholly. I think Ambedkar and Nehru were both modernists who felt that urbanization would lead to prosperity and poverty, and also Ambedkar felt, rightly I think, that in the city there is less caste discrimination. As he says in the Constituent Assembly, that the village is a den of inequity, because in the village you know everybody's caste, but in the cities it's much harder, right? Now, so by and large, Gandhi's economic philosophies were a bit romantic and impractical. At the same time, he had an intuitive environmental understanding of the global limits to the consumer society. When he says that if India emulates the West, it will strip the world bare like locusts. India and China will strip the world bare like locusts. You know, you look at the water crisis in China or the problems we are facing. So if you have urban development without responsible use or without, you know, renewing our villages, I mean, if you look at what's going to happen in the next election, it will be agrarian distress. No, so it's not as if you have done. Where I would disagree with you, sir, is your last point. I think the Indian successive Indian governments have neglected. Look, they have not. I mean, there's nothing Gandhian about any of the policies that we have followed. But yes, on the whole, yes. I mean, again, it goes back to Mr. Jain's question. You know, because Gandhi needed nothing beyond his spectacles and his loincloth, he thought for everyone else that would be fine. You know, that he didn't recognize that human beings have desires, not sexual desires, but a desire for clean water, for a decent house, for education for their children. All this will require a certain amount of industrialization, modernization. And he had not thought through those issues, I would agree with you.
I go to, sir?
Money to keep you poor.
Huh?
He takes the government of India a lot of money to keep you poor.
your introduction.
Good question.
Sir, can you kindly introduce yourself, sir?
Amitesh Singh. I belong to the customs. I'm an addition commissioner, a spouse member. I'd like to ask you a question. Like, Gandhi's canvas was the entire subcontinent. He visited lots of areas now in Pakistan and in Bangladesh. How is he perceived there now? I mean, we're seeing the impression that he left in India.
So, directed. You know, we start thinking only of our own people, right? I mean, who in India remembers Ghaffar Khan now, for example, right? So, with that caveat, Gandhi is, where Gandhi is remembered in Pakistan, it is sympathetic. The people they hate are Nehru and Patel, for whatever reason, rightly or wrongly. Gandhi is remembered sympathetically because of the transparency of his life and because he worked for Hindu Muslim harmony. Similar, but the interesting thing about Gandhi is that his canvas was not the subcontinent, it was the world. And that is what makes him unique among 20th century figures. You know, in the first volume of my biography, Gandhi for India, I talk about how I taught a course in Berkeley called Arguments with Gandhi. And it was the most enjoyable course I ever taught. I mean, it was a class full of Burmese students, Jewish students, Indian students, all kinds of people. Now, and when I was flying back from Berkeley to Bangalore, I thought, if a Berkeley professor came to Bangalore University and offered a course called Arguments with Jefferson, no one would come. So what is extraordinary about Gandhi is how his life and work resonates elsewhere. And many young people today do not like Gandhi. I mean, you will notice this among the younger generation, among your children and so on. They blame him for not just partition. You know, they will say, why did he have Nehru and not Patel? Why did he do this? You know, all kind of things. He was too soft on the Muslims, he was too soft on the Dalits, all kinds of things, right? There's an undercurrent of revulsion against Gandhi among many young Indians and a cult of violence. Now, for example, if you look at how young Indians respond to Gandhi, there's a cult today, and all of you have experienced it in social media and other. There's a cult of Subhash Bose, there's a cult of Bhagat Singh, and there's a cult of Savarkar. There are three cults. If you canvass young men, especially those who are not very well educated, and I suppose more in northern India if you canvass young men, and you ask them to rank these four people, Gandhi, Bhagat Singh, Savarkar and Bose, very likely Gandhi will get the fewest votes, right? Okay. Now, what is interesting is, the people they are worshipping, what is common between Bhagat Singh, Bose and Savarkar? Nothing. One is a Marxist. One is a communal Hindu bigot, namely Savarkar. You know, Bose is a kind of peculiar mishmash of secularism and fascism. The only thing common to them is, they believe in the cult of the gun. Blow the hell out of the opponent. Right? And among young men, so there is, what is interesting in India today is that there is a deep undercurrent of hostility against Gandhi. At the same time, globally his image is growing. Globally his image is growing, right? Maybe not in Africa, but in many other parts of the world. And it could be, this is an interesting speculation I'll leave you with. It could be that like the Buddha, we gave birth to Gandhi and we threw him out and the rest of the world took him out. You know, that might happen. I'd hope, that would be too pessimistic, that won't happen. But the interesting thing is that he is a universal figure. Churchill is a great British hero. De Gaulle is a great French hero. Ho Chi Minh is a great Vietnamese hero. But Gandhi somehow just travels everywhere. And that is quite, that is actually a great tribute to a man who's been dead for 70 odd years. That every part of the world, I mean, you go to Brazil, Professor Kaushik Basu, a well-known economist, he recently posted on Twitter a photograph of a Gandhi street in Mexico City. So that's it. So in a sense, his theater was the whole world.
Yeah. We will be taking only four more questions before I go to any gentleman. I'll go to the lady. Madam, please.
The lady.
Independence movement. As a historian who has chronicled 70 years of modern Indian history, this means not disrespect to Gandhiji, but would you say the Second World War expedited the Indian independence?
Two or three things happened, and this is described in great detail in my book. You know, when the Second War broke out, and I mentioned this before, the British were fighting for their national survival. Right. And the Indians were also fighting for their freedom and self-respect. And Gandhi and the Congress went and met Linlith Gao, the Viceroy, and said, we will even abandon non-violence and support your war effort if you promise us independence afterwards. And if the combination of Linlith Gao, who was the most reactionary viceroy, and Churchill, who was the most imperialist prime minister, scuttled any compromise. So when Gandhi launched his Quit India movement, it was out of desperation. Because he said, look, I'm old, and we want freedom, and these guys are just not listening to us. I mean, just look at the sheer illogic and hypocrisy of the British. They are fighting for freedom against the Nazis, but they won't promise Indians. So, once Quit India movement happened, the British turned very hostile to Gandhi and the Congress. They started promoting Jinnah. Once the Congress leaders were in jail, Jinnah started building the Muslim League all across India, and then partition became inevitable, right? So I would say the Second World War, 1939, makes partition inevitable. Does it hasten Indian independence? That's a different question. Because there'd be elections in 1937 under the Government of India Act, which were already a step towards dominion status. So if the Second World War had not happened, maybe a Labour government would have come to power in Great Britain. They may have promised us independence anyway. So I am agnostic on that. It is true that it is said that the Second World War exhausted the British and they had no resources. But the fact is, the Labour Party was committed to Indian independence from 1910. So what Attlee was doing in 1945 was only fulfilling a commitment made 30 years ago. So I am not sure of that argument, but partition certainly was made much more likely by the Second World War.
Can I have one more from the lady officers, please? Lady officer.
You talked about Gandhi's popularity growing across the world. I'm a personally great admirer, and I've been seeing the different biographies, the great interest and so on. You also mentioned that not in Africa. So could you talk a little bit about Gandhi and the matter of race? That's one part of it. The second part of it, in early on in your talk, you said that it was South Africa that turned a Gujarati banya into an Indian.
Correct.
I'm just wondering, in the 21st century, and we are all of us trying to rediscover Gandhi, rediscover India in different kinds of ways. What is it, do you think, as a biography of Gandhi, as a biographer of Gandhi, could you talk a little bit about what is it that would take, that it would take to turn Indians into Indians?
Yeah, I mean, that's so Gandhi's works, and it's very easy and very common to quote him selectively out of context, to quote what he said something early and to disregard what he said elsewhere. So he was a racist when he went to South Africa as a young man. There is no question that in his 20s he was a racist. Many Indians are still racist. Certainly in the 19th century, Indians felt they were the equals of Europeans, but the Africans could never become the equals of Europeans. So Gandhi reflected that. He was a racist. He made racist comments. The longer he lived in South Africa, the more he outgrew his racism. But he still refused to ally the struggle of the Indians with the struggle of the Africans. He said they'll be separate. Then he comes back. And he has 33 years still to live. And in those 33 years, he radically changes his views and becomes a principled anti-racist. From the 20s onwards, in the 20s, he is writing in the journal of the great African-American leader W.E.B. Du Bois, having correspondence with him. In the 1930s, the African-American press is writing about him. One of Martin Luther King's mentors, Howard Thurman, goes to his ashram in Sevagram. It's all described in the book. You know, there he tells the Indians in South Africa, you have to ally with the Africans. That is, their struggle is more important than yours. Don't only think about your selfish interests. So he starts as a racist and becomes a principled anti-racist. And, you know, ideologues who want to selectively quote, forget the rest. Now, however, at the same time, it's my view and not my view alone, that the Indian Foreign Ministry and maybe the politicians, the foreign ministers, it's not their business to be promoting statues of Gandhi in Africa. Let the Africans decide whom they want. You know, why should we it goes back to a kind of patronizing attitude that I must say, though I admire Nehru greatly, Nehru's party is responsible for. This sense that we are the leaders of the non-aligned movement. You know, we were the first nation to get freedom from the British, and we will teach the Africans and the other Asians how to go. And Foreign Service officers defend this, you know, but that's wrong. Why should we tell the Africans, if an African on his own wants to put up a statue of Gandhi, fine. But why should the Indian Foreign Minister go to Ghana and say, here is so many $1,000s and here is an Indian sculptor going to erect a statue, right? So those are two separate questions. Now, your second question, you know, I don't want to prescribe as to what Indians should learn, but I'd say they are kind of, in the conclusion to my book, I talk about, you know, four aspects of Gandhi's life that are of enduring relevance to the whole world, including India. The first is that within a country, within a society, within a country, if you want to resist injustice, do so non-violently. You know, so I have no sympathy with the Naxalites. I have no sympathy with the Karsevaks who burnt, you know, minority homes in 1992. I have no sympathies with the jihadis in Kashmir. So, because all cannot just, you know, if another country attacks you, you need an army. But, and by all means, resist injustice. You know, it, like just the other day, there was a satyagraha of a village women who came to the Vidhan Sabha about alcoholism. I'm just, you know, which was recently reported in the press. Well, that's fine. They are angry that, you know, fake liquor is being sold, that the state government is not doing enough, you know, has an interest in revenue generation from toddy. So they're upset about it, so they protest. You know, they come and get out of Vidhan Sabha by all means. That is completely democratic, right? But, so that's the first aspect of Gandhi's life and message, that resist injustice, do it collectively, but do it without causing violence and bodily harm to people. That's the first. The second part is interfaith harmony. I mean, this is relevant all over the world. I mean, the world is now riven by religious misunderstanding. You know, it's not just India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Syria, America. I mean, this is just awful. And Gandhi's whole life was about, you know, interfaith harmony. And of course, I mean, I have a column coming next week on the subject with regards to India particularly. The third would be what I mentioned, you know, his environmental responsibility. He had a sense that, you know, you can't just recklessly consume. And the fourth is just the transparency of his life. You know, anyone could walk into his ashram, anyone could debate to him, you wrote to him, you wrote back. You know, it's extraordinary. I mean, and the fifth, actually the last thing, which is not really mentioned in my book, but I've been thinking more and more about this aspect of Gandhi's life. He had a really great ability. To make leaders out of followers, to identify talent, you know, Nehru, Patel, Kamala Devi, Rajaji, Bose, whoever, identify talent, work with them, and take them to the next level and leave them free to grow. Right? Now, if you look at the kind of people Gandhi nurtured, Zakir Hussain in education, J.C. Kumarappa in rural development, Kamala Devi in women's rights, Nehru, Patel, Rajaji, Kriplani, Lohia, JP, I mean, it's amazing. Look at the remarkable figures he nurtured, right? Now that's a really great achievement. Yeah. And that's a lesson in leadership. Yeah. And it's a lesson in leadership not only, it's of course true of politics. What is common to Nehru, Indira Gandhi and Modi, they never nurtured anyone apart from themselves. Whatever the differences politically, you know, they were different kinds of people. But they never left a second rung to take forward what their ideas were. You know, in cricket, I mean, Virat Kohli thinks he's a, you know, a superman. CEOs run their companies as there's no one after them. Right. And this is something which of course is an extraordinary thing. I mean, how do you, and it's because of Gandhi's openness, you know, and he could, and he I mean, you just look at, he died in 1948. But what are the reasons? It was confidently predicted by the West that when Gandhi is dead, India would collapse. Confidently predicted. But the reason it did not collapse was there were these other people he had trained who took the ship of state forward. And that's a very rare attribute of leaders, you know, because charismatic leaders tend to think it's all about themselves, you know, and it's not just true in politics, it can be true in business, science, you know, I mean, the scientists can be unbelievable megalomaniacs, you know, and so I think including some scientists in this city, which I would be happy to name if you want, right, actually I've named them in print, so if you just Google, you'll find it, and I'll give you the alternative, you know, the greatest, one of the two scientists I really admire, Satish Dhawan, both in the city, Satish Dhawan and Obed Siddiqui, so I'll give the positive side, since yes. My friend to my left is upset that I'll get you all of you into trouble, okay, but I'll give you the, okay. Satish Dhawan and Obed Siddiqui had this ability to nurture successors. Right? Homi Bhabha didn't. Homi Bhabha's room as director could not be occupied after he died. He died, it became a shrine to him. Right? He may be a great scientist. Right? So this is some of the things that Gandhi taught that go beyond that.
Sir, please, sir. I go to Madam Nelson.
Who doesn't find a direct mention in any of what was said in these last few minutes.
Yeah.
I feel that there's a deliberate move to denigrate him and to push up Sardar Patel as though they were in opposition to each other on the actual battlefield, which they were not. They were fighting as comrades.
Yes,
they have different talents, different aspects of their personalities. I'm a great admirer of Jawaharlal Nehru, but that's not why I'm saying what I'm saying now. I think he should be given his rightful place. The Discovery of India, the one book, itself shows what a depth of feeling and understanding he had for this country. How can we denigrate him in order to build up somebody else? Yes, I can understand there was more than one hero in the Indian freedom movement, and he's not the only one. But you cannot, for that reason, put down his role and say that somebody else is greater than he. What do you think of this whole effort put down Nehru and put up?
So that's a very important question you raised, Mr. Narayanaswamy, and I have, as on most things, strong views on it. I begin with a statement made by Gopal Krishna Gandhi, and it's as follows. It's dealing with the current polarization you talk about. The Congress disowned Nehru, so the BJP misowned Patel. Sorry, the Congress disowned Patel. The Congress disowned Patel, so the BJP misowned Patel. Namely, Patel was a congressman, but the Congress of Indira Gandhi onwards disowned him. Because for them it was only Nehru. They made such a cult of Nehru that there could be no one else. They disowned not only Nehru, but also Rajaji, Kamraj, everyone else, right? And then the Patel, the BJP very smartly picked him up, even though he had no part of that. Now, Nehru, Gandhiji was absolutely right in nominating Nehru as his successor.
Yeah.
And I'll explain why. It goes back to how I started, about his going to South Africa to become an Indian. After Gandhi, Nehru was the least parochial of Indians. In the Congress, working with Gandhiji, Rajaji was brilliant, but he was a Tamil Brahmin, and that's all he was in his mentality. Patel was a Gujarati patidar. Nehru was a Hindu who appealed to Muslims, a North Indian who respected South Indians, and a man who stood for full